Okay. So the roadmap for today is the following. I'll start by guiding you shortly through the sort of received accounts of measurement success in science, epistemic success in scientific measurement. I'll focus mainly on the currently dominant coherentist account of successful measurement, which highlights that su epistemic success is expressed by the coherence, or the numerical convergence between the measurement outcomes that are inferred from different indicators and different contexts. I'll then introduce you sort of to the technicalities and historical origins of the problem of measuring the Earth polar flattening. And before I, one second, I'll the sort of in the next section, which is the sort of historical bulk of my argument, I'll trace the results of these measurements from roughly 1750 to 1880. It's roughly one century, and I'll show that geodesists failed to reach the kind of convergence that is implied in the dominant account. I'll argue that based on their own sort of self-assessment, that these measurements should still be considered epistemically successful. And I'll sort of end up by wrapping up the kinds of epistemic success they achieved in a sort of revised version of coherentism that can account for it. Okay, and I think this dynamic coherentism, again, is particularly relevant for cases that are heavily model-mediated cases of measurement. And I'll hope to convince you that this is the case. Okay, so when is a measurement epistemically successful? You know, one straightforward way to approach this question is starting with a sort of a mathematical characterization of measurement. That is, philosophers have taken this as an inspiration to talk about measurement success, going back to the representational theory of measurement, influential work. So the idea broadly is that measurement is construed sort of as a kind of mapping, homomorphism that is structure-preserving mapping from a set of empirical relational structures onto a certain numerical relational structures, so that the sort of relational properties unique to the relations between the different magnitudes of a quantity are preserved in the numerical relational structures that sort of represent them, like the real numbers or the natural numbers. And some philosophers have sort of taken this view as an inspiration to argue that theoretically, quantity could be considered successfully measured if its indicators behave according to an empirical law whose relational structure maps homomorphically onto the structure of a scale type of interest. So the kind of view of measurement justification accompanying this is the idea that you first have to have empirical knowledge about the relational structure of the attribute under measurement. And if you have that knowledge, you know, you're justified to measure the phenomenon in a certain way on a scale type of a certain level of informativeness. Okay, so the problem of deriving a view of empirical measurement success from the representational theory, as that strictly speaking, it's not concerned with empirical success. It's just giving you a mathematical characterization. And it's also not really concerned with derived measurement, but with foundational measurement, fundamental measurement, like, for example, the measurement of length with a measuring rod, where you just infer length from your indicator directly. Most measurements in science are derived measurements, however, where you do not directly infer the quantity of interest, but you infer it from another observable quantity. Say, think about measuring temperature, where you infer the temperature from the expansion rate of mercury in a glass thermometer. So RTM is just, it's not usually intended to capture these questions. Why sort of it isn't really helpful to study measurement practice in this regard is mostly that in measurement practice, you can't do the kind of foundational justification that philosophers sort of have been inspired to articulate by RTM. Namely because for foundational justification, right, you have to have antecedent knowledge of the empirical relational structure that you're measuring. In a measurement practice, this is often not the case. So the empirical law that you need to describe your quantity is often itself under investigation in the measurement process. So neither, like you neither have an antecedent correct measurement procedure nor an antecedent correct theory about what it is that you're measuring. This is nicely sort of cashed out in this notion of a problem of coordination, or also sometimes called a problem of gnomic measurement. The two notions are, I'll treat them as equivalent today. And Ha-seok Chang gives sort of a nice characterization of this. He sort of formalized this problem as follows. We want to measure a quantity X, and it's a derived measurement, so it's not directly observable. We inferred from an indicator quantity, which is directly observable. For this inference, obviously, we need a law that expresses X as a function of Y. But the problem is, since we do not know x yet, we just want to find out about x through our measurement. Logically speaking, we cannot discover this function because for that we would already need to know about x and the relationship, the gnomic relation between x and y. So I have like logically speaking, a vicious circularity since we want to gain knowledge about quantity x. But to justify the measurement procedure that we're using to gain knowledge, we already require the knowledge that we want to gain. And most accounts, sort of the coherently dominant coherentist accounts, have been conceived as a response to this kind of situation, where they specify how this vicious logical circularity can be turned into a sort of virtuous practical epistemological circularity. So Ha-Seok Chung's coherentism is a case in point. He argues that you can break sort of this problem by not starting, like where you have a lack of foundational justification, by starting with a principle of respect to the imperfect measurement procedures or theories that you're starting with. So you start with an imperfect theory that describes your measurement situation. You make a measurement, your measurement will have some discrepancies, some incoherencies, you come up with a better theoretical characterizations. Do a better measurement procedure, again, you'll have discrepancies, you again improve your theory and so on. So the justification works is based, or you justify the measurements and theories in virtue of their contribution to sort of an iterative process of correction. And this is a productive circularity, since Chang assumes that if this iteration succeeds, you'll see a gradual convergence between the outcomes that you measure. So here's a coherentist account of measurement justification, where you break the vicious circularity, apparently vicious circularity, and a productive process of iterative successive correction. Okay. Another way of catching this out was given in Aaron Tall's famous model-based account. Of the framing in terms of models is really suited for what we'll discuss later. He talks about measurement as a sort of model-mediated inference, where you have measurement indicators. Here in my sort of slide, you see a sketch of a thermometer. And a model of a measurement interaction that consists of all the theoretical and statistical assumptions that you make. And based on that model, you can infer from your indication, you can infer a quantity that is stated sort of in the theoretical language of inference. So derived measurements are really model-mediated inferences on this account. And again, he sort of even goes a step further as Chang, since he does not solely talk about in a justification, he gives you straightforward success criterion for measurements. Where he argues that measurements are epistemically successful if the numerical outcomes inferred from different instrumental indicators and in different contexts are numerically consistent inside of sort of some predicted error margin. Okay, so here's a success criterion in terms of coherence, which in turn is defined in terms of numerical consistency. Okay, so let's sort of look at the technicalities of the case study, keeping this characterization of measurement success in mind. So how do you measure the Earth polar flattening? So I think the best way to understand these geodetic measurements is to look at the dispute that they originated from between Isaac Newton and Christian Huygens, another Cartesian physicist that we'll leave out for the sake of simplicity. Newton, as most of you know, famously postulated that gravitational attraction between any two particles varies as the inverse square of their distance. This is a sort of a universal law, right, holding between any two pieces of matter, although he derived it from Kepler's law, describing the Kepler's laws, describing the orbits of planets. And Huygens says, the generalization from these celestial observations to a law of holding between any two pieces of matter is unjustified, since gravity is really a central force that acts towards the center of planets, and you can't just generalize it to any two particles, or any particles, yeah. Okay, so how do you adjudicate between those different claims? Well, one experimentum crux is the figure of the Earth. How can that be an experimentum cruxus? Well, Newton and Huygens sort of agree on some assumptions. They agree that you can model the Earth or idealize the Earth as a homogeneous rotating fluid. In this way, sort of they propose to approximate all the effects that gravitation has on the figure of the Earth in sort of the long in its long existence. So you don't treat it as a solid body but a fluid, since it's been subjected to these forces for so long. And since you can see that the Earth is in some kind of equilibrium, right, it's not constantly deforming and the water is not splashing off the sides, you can come up with an estimate of the Earth's figure by looking at the kinds of figures that a rotating fluid attracting, like being subjected to some law of gravity, would take to be in dynamical equilibrium. And both agree, right, that there's a centrifugal effect due to the inertia of the around the rotational axis, of the fluid moving around the rotational axis. So both agree that this equilibrium figure will have some equatorial bulge, it will be oblate. But since Huygens thinks gravity is the central force, and Newton thinks it's a universal force, on Newton's account, the Earth, like this equilibrium figure, will be flattened to a higher extent, to a stronger degree. Because if gravity just acts towards the center, you know, like there's a smaller boost than if it acts universally, because, you know, it will also act between the different particles in the equatorial bulge. Okay, so here you sort of have the crucial model that we'll be talking about in what follows as well, this ellipsoid model of the Earth. Later, you know, these theoretical considerations were significantly improved, mainly by the work of the French geodesist Alexis Clairaut, who showed that the ellipsoid can also be an equilibrium figure for a fluid that is not fully homogeneous, but has sort of a density distribution that is spherically symmetric and increases towards the center. And the definition of our measurement target now is the definition of the Earth's polar flattening. It's defined in terms of the ellipticity of an ellipsoid of revolution, the ratio between its equatorial and polar axis. And so how would you go about then measuring this quantity to adjudicate between the different hypotheses? So Newton proposes two ways of doing this. One is based on the variation of surface gravity on the Earth's surface. The other one is based on the variation in the Earth's curvature. The idea behind them is roughly similar. On a flattened Earth, the surface gravity at the poles should be the strongest because there's the most mass compressed beneath it. So as you move up in latitude from the equator to the poles, the strength of surface gravity should increase, and you should be able to infer the flattening of the poles based on the form of that function. Similarly, the same stretch of one meridian of the Earth should be the longest at the poles, since the Earth is curved most strongly. So as you move up from the equator to the poles, the same section of a meridian should get longer, and the variation in the length of this meridian, the function describing it, should allow you to infer the Earth polar flattening. Okay, how does this play out in practice? So for the first measurement, you rely on a seconds pendulum, and later there are more sophisticated pendulums developed, but this sort of helps to illustrate the point. It was developed by Christian Huygens himself. So with a seconds pendulum, you can infer the strength of surface gravity based on the length that the pendulum needs to be in to complete the swing in exactly 1 second. Well, you also need a function that relates this variation to the overall flattening, which is sort of derived from this equilibrium figure theory, most succinctly stated by Clairaut. And then you measure the variation in surface gravity at different degrees of latitude, and you try to match it with an ellipsoid model with an ellipticity that accounts for these variations with the least residual error possible. And then the ellipticity of that ellipsoid model gives you a magnitude for the flattening of the Earth. Sure. Apologies. Okay. The second indicator, similar but slightly more practically complicated. To measure the variation in the length of a meridional arc with latitude, you would have to do a triangulation, which is in essence a very sophisticated form of distance measurement, in which you physically measure a baseline with a measuring rod. But since you do not want to measure like such a giant stretch of land physically, it would be too many random errors introduced. You sort of embed this this baseline and a network of triangles whose angles you measure optically, and using spherical geometry, then you can infer the length of all the sides of the triangles in the network based on your baseline. And then like some of these angles, right, will form the meridian, as you can see sort of here in the example. And so you have the length of the meridian. To do these measurements, you have to astronomically orient your triangulation network so that it really follows the meridian and is not misaligned, and that it really covers the same stretch of a meridian at different degrees of latitude. And you measure this as varying degrees of latitude, the length of the meridional arcs. And again, you measure the variations that that you measure with the dimensions of an ellipsoid model. I mentioned Gauss and Laplace here, and Legendre should also be mentioned because they come up with the least square method of error calculus, which sort of is the most sophisticated way of doing this matching. And finally, the ellipticity of the ellipsoid you arrive at gives you a value for the flattening of the Earth. Okay, and here's like a nice map that gives you an overview of the different arc measurements that were conducted before 1857, sorry. See here one in Peru, here two in the British Isles, Sweden, Baltic Sea, and French that was later sort of extended. Okay, just before moving on, just like to summarize in how far this is a model mediated inference. So first, as we see in the measurement, target is defined as a parameter of a highly idealized model, which is abstracted from the physical Earth interior constitution, its topography and gravity field. And second, the inferences, the specific measurement inferences from the local variations in the two measurement indicators, presume that these indicators vary elliptically with the Earth, vary elliptically, right? So that they can be accommodated in an ellipsoid model. Since you choose the ellipsoid model in such a way that it minimizes the residual error, you already presume it in your measurement inference. Okay. So let's look how at the results of these measurements over time. So here are some values, the most important values in the middle of the 18th century. The two you should focus on are the fourth and the fifth value, one measured in South Africa, one arc, and one arc measured in Italy. The South African arc, as you can see, is closer to the equator than the Italian one. So it should technically be shorter than the Italian one, but as you can see, the length is given in toise, which is which is a French unit of measurement. The Italian arc actually ends up being shorter, although it should be longer if the Earth would be an ellipsoid. So that's sort of the first matching problem where these values seem to not be able to be accommodated by the ellipsoid model. These problems intensify, and geodesists really start to worry about them. Here's the great French physicist Pierre-Simon Laplace in 1799 in his Mécanique Céleste, writing that it seems to follow from the preceding measures that the variations of the degrees of the terrestrial meridian differ sensibly from the law of the square of the scene of the latitude, which is given by the hypothesis of their elliptical meridians. Similar judgment was reached by the German astronomer Anton von Zach, who argues that it's doubtful whether the Earth is an ellipsoid. Rather, it seems to have a completely irregular figure in which neither all meridians nor all latitudes have an identical shape. Okay. These problems concerning the accuracy of the background model were sort of cited with another problem. Once pendulum measures were first conducted systematically, the important experiments here are the ones conducted by the Irish astronomer Edward Sabine, who did a global survey of pendulum length in the 1820s. And here's George Biddle Airy, the Cambridge professor of mathematics, the old chair held by Newton, and later Astronomer Royal in Greenwich, commenting on the survey by Sabine, arguing that the ellipticity of the Earth, deduced by Captain Sabine from a series of pendulum experiments, the most extensive and apparently the most deserving of confidence that has ever been made, differs considerably from that which, as is generally believed, is indicated by geodetic measures, whereby he means the triangulation measures. Okay, so now we have actually two problems. The first problem is about a worry about the accuracy of the model and how far it is an accurate approximation of the Earth. The second problem is that the two indicators that you can use to check the accuracy of the model seem be affected by some form of systematic error because they are misaligned with each other. So you have sort of a textbook version of a problem of coordination, where your imperfect model could only be tested based on some measurements that already presume the model in their application. Okay, so how do you break this? Well, coherentists have a strategy, right? They argue we should employ a principle of respect and record discordances or incoherencies in the measurements and then improve them by improving theory, model, and or measurement procedures. And in fact, that's also like the attitude that many geodesists took. Here's Carl Friedrich Gauss, a famous mathematician and geodesist, arguing that given this state of things, nothing prohibits us from continuing to treat the Earth as an ellipsoid of revolution, from which the true geometrical surface deviates everywhere in stronger, weaker, longer, or shorter undulations. Okay, so use the model, record the shortcomings, and try to explain or anticipate the shortcomings afterwards. It's a prime example of a sort of iterative strategy. However, in the case of geodesy, this seems like this iterative process promised to be very, very complicated and tedious. Here's Airy arguing that enough measurements and a sufficient amount of points on the Earth's surface appeared impossible ever to execute. Gauss saying that that would imply the unreachable ideal of spinning a net of triangulations around the entire Earth, or at least interconnecting all the European observatories. And indeed, their pessimistic predictions would prove accurate. Here's an overview of the measurement outcomes that were achieved in the next decades. You can see nicely how the pendulum measures indicated with the dots systematically are in conflict with the arc measurements, which are the triangles. Roughly until the 1880s, there was no significant convergence between those different measurements, which on the coherentist account should indicate that these measurements should not be considered as epistemically successful, right? And what follows, I'll argue that this is actually not the case. Geodesists, in fact, did achieve significant epistemic success without achieving convergence. And as a witness, and there are many witnesses, but this is a particular knowledgeable one. Here's Isaac Todhunter, who wrote this sort of still authoritative history of mathematical geodesy. It's called A History of Mathematical Theories of Attraction and the Figure of the Earth. British mathematician writing in the 1870s that the history of science presents no example in which the object obtained, namely the knowledge of the Earth's figure and the insight that it is not a regular one, is so far surpassed by the incidental gain which in the course of its long and arduous pursuit has accrued in the general cultivation and advancement of mathematical and astronomical knowledge. And don't take mathematical and astronomical too literal, because geodesy was often seen as merging with the two disciplines. Okay, so what were those incidental gains, right? He clearly tells us that there was significant knowledge gained through those geodetic measurements, even though they were not converging. To just be a bit analytical about it, I propose this concept of residual knowledge to encompass it. And I take residual knowledge to refer to novel forms of useful data and theoretical insights that are direct byproducts of the iterative improvement of a model-based metric. And they're drawn from the investigation of some form of residual error, measurement error. And in what follows, I look at the empirical or theoretical insights that were in fact gained by employing the two measurement procedures we just sketched. So first, the empirical insights, the new kinds of data. So notably, you can, even if the ellipset model is imperfect, you can employ it as a reference surface in very productive ways. So for example, in a certain regions, the deviations of the model offer a way to quantify the Earth's topography, a way to record altitude and improve mapping. Deviations from the normal surface gravity in the region predicted by the model can guide subsequent geological investigation, because they indicate, you know, some density irregularity beneath the Earth's surface, which you could investigate. In fact, this method of reference modeling is well studied for the case of geophysics by Taro Miyake, focusing on seismology in an article from 2015. It actually goes back, the term reference modeling goes back to an 1880 geodesy textbook by the German geodesist Friedrich Roman Hermann. So we have a nice historical origin of this term. Okay. More importantly, however, geodesists gain significant theoretical insights from their imperfect measurements. I'll focus on one particularly crucial example, which occurred in the so-called Great Trigonometrical Survey of India by the British colonial authorities. So in 1856, the surveyor Robert Shortreed notices an unusual gravitational effect on the orientation of a triangulation network. So remember that a triangulation network needs to be oriented astronomically, so that it doesn't misalign with a meridian it tries to sort of follow, and that it covers the right extent in length. Share of the meridian. So to do this, right, you have to do an astronomical measurement, you have to orient your telescope relative to the local direction of gravity. And if there's a massive mountain range like the Himalayas in the vicinity, you will want to anticipate the effect that the Himalayas, the mass of the Himalayas, has on the orientation of your telescope. So what geodesists would do normally is, here's a nice sketch illustrating this kind of deflection of the vertical of the direction of gravity. What geodesists would usually do is they try to correct for it. Now, in the Himalayas, in the survey, they noticed that they in fact did not cause such a positive gravity anomaly, although obviously the Himalayas are a massive mountain range. So why was that the case? To explain it, geodesists proposed a theory of isostatic compensation, which argues that mass surpluses in topography are in fact compensated by density deficits in the Earth's interior. There are two different models of compensation proposed, one by Henry Pratt, a geodesist in India, and the other one by George Airy, that we already talked about, by then Astronomer Royal in Greenwich. So Pratt proposes that there's a vertical compensation, so that inside of the Earth crust, there's a vertical there are vertical density deficits that compensate for the extra mass in the topography. Airy proposes rather that there's a mass deficit because the extra topography makes the Earth crust push away parts of the Earth's liquid mantle, such that which is heavy, liquid but heavier, such that this mass surplus in the topography is compensated by the extra mass, by the mass deficit in the liquid mantle. Okay, so this is a really successful theory. In fact, it grounds later the modern theory of continental drift, which is still our predominant, our current theory of the Earth continental dynamics, and it's one of the foundations of modern geophysics. So as we've seen, right, geodesists did gain significant empirical and theoretical insights from the imperfect incoherent measurements. And I'll now try to encompass these insights in a refined version of coherentism. So just to repeat our motivation, right, we saw that coherentism could account for one aim of geodesists. Clearly, they try to improve the coherence between their imperfect measures in an iterative process, and, you know, Gauss quote and a similar attitude is taken by Airy, our prime examples for that. However, coherentism fails to capture the reason for which they eventually regarded their measurements as epistemically successful. So what is this reason? How can we sort of flesh it out philosophically? One way to pose this question is to ask what is epistemically distinctive about residual knowledge, right? Since we saw that the insights that geodesists gain were what I call residual knowledge. I have referred to residual knowledge as sort of the novel empirical and theoretical insights gained from the study of residual error and measurement data. This maps nicely on a sort of established philosophical concept of fruitfulness, and many important, you know, philosophers and scientists have referred to the capacity of a theory or a research program to facilitate empirical and theoretical insights as its fruitfulness. So analogously, we can sort of flesh out the success criteria that geodesists employed as measurement fruitfulness, right? So a measurement procedure can be fruitful if its fruitfulness can be assessed based on the novel empirical and theoretical insights that can be inferred from the data that it generates. Okay, one thing that's noteworthy about fruitfulness is that it's a dynamic criterion. It's not, you can't assess it as you can do with coherence, sort of synchronically. It pertains to the performance of epistemic activities over time, of measurements over time, and the novel insights you can gain by measuring a phenomenon in a certain way over time, and then continuing the novel path of inquiry, if you want, that these measurements open. So corresponding to these two kinds of success criteria, I think that two kinds of measurement success that they indicate. The coherence obviously indicates some kind of coordinative success, which is well studied in the literature, indicating coherence between our knowledge about a target phenomenon and our measurement interactions with it. So the heart of standard coherentism guides lots of metrological practice currently, right, like in the International Bureau of Weights and Measures, and gives you one of the primary forms of evidence for theoretical definitions that is or model that is successfully coordinated. However, there's also a dynamic form of success, of measurement success, and dynamic success indicates the novel insights, you know, that we gain by draw from measuring a certain phenomenon in a certain way. So just to like sort of locate this view in the literature a bit, of course there are influential studies of discordant measurements, but I think my account makes a sort of crucial step beyond them. Because it's not based on an eventual evidential closure of these discordances. So famous account, probably the most famous, is by George Smith, who studied Probert's account of measurement discordance in astronomy, seismology, and molecular physics. So he has this idea of epistemic loops, where discordant plays a huge role in generating evidence for theory, since the measurement discordances, say, for example, in Newtonian gravity, there's a theoretical prediction that's incoherent with an outcome that you measure for the orbit of a planet. Then you can postulate based on the theory you start with, you derive your prediction from, you can postulate an explanation for that discordance. For example, a new planet that also tracks according to Newton's laws. So if you then can explain your earlier discordance by the same theory that you used initially, the evidence on that initial theory is significantly increased. So you have a kind of epistemic looping effect, which consecutively increases the evidence for your background theory or model. And similar account was recently defended by Elisa Bokolic, looking at the calibration of geological timescales, who argues that sort of if you have a prolonged incoherence or discordance, And it is eventually resolved. The evidence that this calibration then, this successful calibration then provides is stronger. What I want to argue rather is not that the eventual evidence from the overcoming of a measurement discordance or incoherency is increased once it is overcome. I want to argue that even if this discordance is not eliminated, there's important successful, like this measurements can be in important ways, non-trivial ways, epistemically successful by fostering residual knowledge and allowing inferences to further and novel phenomena. Okay, there is a historical predecessor though that I have to give credit to. That's John Herschel's conception of residual phenomena, which was also, you know, taken up by William Weil and John Stuart Mill. And in fact, there's an excellent paper on this forthcoming by Taro Miyake who told me about it. Okay. So just to sum up, before I close, the dynamic coherentism that I defended here is the view that epistemic success in scientific measurements should be assessed based both on its coherence and fruitfulness. It implies, of course, the claim that coordinative and dynamic measurement success are not fully coextensive, right? So residual knowledge can be epistemically valuable without improving the coherence of its underlying measurement inferences. And maybe as a nice closing note, I think that such an extended view of the epistemic success of measurement is particularly relevant for measurements that rely on a highly idealized theoretical model, the ones that we use when we study more complex target systems where we need to make simplifying idealizing assumptions, because there we don't have the same degree of knowledge of perturbing background effects, and there's more potential fruitful novel insights that we can gain in the process. So we shouldn't artificially constrain the epistemic potential of our measurements by a limited account of measurement success. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Miguel. That was a fascinating presentation. And thank you everyone for attending.